Well, that went right to my head, I'll tell you that. I am going to be talking about cybersecurity, data breaches, and safe computing in a very different way than you've probably heard today thus far. I am a lawyer by background. I think I'm duty-bound to tell you that. I'm a repentant lawyer, but I am a lawyer by background. And have purposely titled the presentation Hacks, Flacks, and Attacks, Collaborating on Risk Communications. The reason that we titled it with that kind of alliterative creativity was not only to draw your interest into the topic, but to give you a clear sense that when we hear about cyber incidents, we hear about Sony getting hacked, we hear about the FBI getting hacked, the CIA getting hacked, Church of Scientology getting hacked. That one I enjoyed, I have to tell you that. You begin to see that there's a pattern emerging, and that is that, A, this is ubiquitous. It's happening to everybody. And what's interesting about that is in my circles, I'm in the crisis management business. And crisis management used to be a very difficult equation because the crisis really assumed low probability of something happening, tsunami, force majeure, a dust explosion in a sugar plant like we had in Atlanta, a client of ours in Atlanta. Low probability, high impact. That's changed a little bit, and it's certainly different in the context of cybersecurity and data security. It's high probability and high impact. So what does that mean? That means that the environment in which this is happening affects more than just the chief security officer or the head of infrastructure, the head of IT, the CIO, all of the people with acronyms that are important. All those people are critically important, but the world in which they play is a much bigger world because all of us are watching when a cyber incident occurs. When Anonymous goes in to, you name it, when Anonymous goes in to the Scientology, let's just say, people are watching. They don't know what to make of it. They don't understand it. So how do you help that world understand the environment in which this is happening, particularly for companies who have essentially told their customers, you can trust us, you can rely on us, we will keep your interests and your data and your information as secure as possible. How do you engage with those people? Got to show your work. I don't know how many of you had math classes. I'm a little older than many of you. But in math class, it was always not what your answer was, but you had to show your work. How did you get to that answer? Or how did you get to that conclusion? Or how did you get to that decision? And then like 29 years later when I was in law school, same thing again. Doesn't matter if you decided A was right or B was right, you had to show the work that justified your conclusion. And that's really the point of this presentation. The security expert, be it in federal government, at the CIA or the FBI, when they were hacked, whether it's a company that's in the exhibition booth, I don't know how many of you were overwhelmed by how many booths were there, I was. Other than the freebies, I probably would have bogged out a little bit earlier. No, they were all very good. But the imperative to integrate into the cyber and data security preparedness and into incident response, the CSO, the CMO, and the CIO, and a bunch of other acronyms into the mix as subject matter expert, but also understand that publics like you are watching very, very closely and need to understand what's going on and need to hear from you as a company, as a government entity, as a public citizen of whatever dimension, need to understand to the best of their ability and the ability to communicate with them and engage with them what is actually happening. Only way to do that is to partner with the expert and those people that have those relationships or know what the tools and tactics look like for public communications. The challenge with communicating after an incident or during an incident is that the speed of risk, the speed of information flow, and I don't have to tell you, is instant. And there is no way to have anything close to good information in the immediate hours after an attack. Absolutely impossible. And what happens is that everybody freezes. And they either say nothing, they fumble around, they literally don't know what to do. I see this every day. And the fact of the matter is they're accountable. They have a duty to get out in front of the public and get out in front of their customers and in front of their investors, whomever stakeholder group, whatever stakeholder group might be affected or might be interested, might be concerned, might have a strong opinion, could be public officials, about the issue, and they need to be able to communicate. What's even more challenging is if they're not well, it's going to happen anyway, either whether or not they're communicating, but facts become quickly negotiable. Facts and information in this day and age are negotiable. Facts and truth, while they've been negotiable since the dawn of time, are the consequence of that now is much more significant because you've got such a dispersion of information flow. So if nobody's talking about the Symantec hack or the Nortel hack by China or some state actor, I just conclude that it's China because that's the information out there. That's actually documented, but no one wants to be that blunt. The fact of the matter is suddenly there'll be this trading of information that's presented as fact when it's opinion. So unless you own the communication channel and you own the position of the company, with whatever information you have, that the reality becomes negotiable, much like a stock on the New York Stock Exchange or it trades, the value trades. So the value of information and the value of your reputation is being traded if you're not engaged. So what does that mean? Okay, so that's interesting. What does an effective response look like when you don't know who did it? You don't know, you really don't have any information other than it happened. An effective response is accountability. This, own it. This happened. Give it, run through when I said show your work in an earlier slide. What do you have in place to prevent these kinds of risks? Because particularly for technology companies, that goes to your core business competency. You're expected to have thought about this. When you get, particularly when, as I said before, if hacking is an inevitability and the studies prove that, then you're certainly charged with the responsibility of having anticipated this kind of risk. What's changed is I think the public has shifted a little bit. You're not expected necessarily to have prevented it depending on the nature of the risk, which we'll talk about a little bit later. So accountability. Talk about what you have in place to prevent these kinds of things. Talk about how you pursue these kinds of things. Talk about your workaround solutions when these things happen. And most important, tell your customers, your shareholders, whomever it is that's listening and needs to hear from you, what they can expect of you moving forward, that action statement, that resolve that you're committed to a solution and committed to taking care of the problem. All this sounds highly intuitive, rarely happens. Why? Why doesn't it happen? Lack of a plan. I speak at conferences all the time on crisis management, and I go into industries where there's pretty high risk of things happening, like the energy industry, for example, or manufacturing. And I ask by show of hands, how many of you have a crisis management plan in place that goes beyond known problems and known fixes? That goes beyond the kinds of things that you know how to fix, like a pipeline explosion. Natural gas companies know how to do that. Show up in a room of 100, maybe I get 3 hands. You have to have a plan. And why is that important? The same reason why Weight Watchers and Jenny Craig and you name 100,000 diet plans that make a lot of money. Why do they make so much money? To tell us what we know intuitively. They tell us to lower sugar, lower fat intake, exercise more. There's nothing in a diet plan that any one of us in this room couldn't figure out on our own. Why? Because it guides you. It takes the emotion out of decision making, which is why a crisis plan is so important. And it has to be more than functional. Who makes the decisions? How do decisions get vetted? How does information travel from one person to the next? It takes the emotion out of decision making, or it dials it down considerably so that you can focus on the problem. Routinely, without a crisis plan, everybody's running to the high side of the ship. They're mistaking motion for progress and really not getting anywhere. And what's worse is that many times, depending on the hack, not all crises are equivalent. Some crises are minor. Some are moderate. Some are severe. It's kind of like weather warnings. A tornado warning doesn't mean, or a tornado watch doesn't require you to take shelter in your basement. A tornado warning might, and certainly a tornado does. But using that analogy is useful because that's exactly how you need to look at crisis as it comes in and calibrate your communications, your decision making, and your activation strategy based on what's happening on the ground. Let's look at a case study. You would think, and I'm not being critical, but you would think that a company, and they're not alone, but Sony, I think, is a good example because they had two recent stabs at the Apple. Sony, everybody knows about the PlayStation breach. Absolutely fumbled. Just could not get the act together. It goes back to what I was saying before. Running to the high side of the ship, running to the customers, running to the investors, running to, you name it, and they were running. And just couldn't get it together because they just didn't know what to say because they didn't really have good information. And it absolutely froze them, absolutely paralyzed them, cost them a lot in market capitalization, cost them a lot in consumer trust, cost them a lot in sales. And the fact of the matter is, all they really needed to do, and again, it isn't simple. I say it's simple because I've given this speech a couple hundred times. To get out there and own the issue, talk about what they have in place to guard against these things. It turns out that it wasn't as organized as it should have been. Lesson learned. They can say that. You know, we live in a political world where taking a position that shows vulnerability in a campaign can be devastating. Corporate world's different. That relationship of trust that corporations can build with a customer is very different than the relationship of a politician campaigning with a public. And unfortunately, too many of us draw on, particularly in corporate positions, draw on the campaign model and say, well, if we don't have certainty, if we don't know exactly what's happening, we lose all credibility. No. You say you don't know, but that you'll be damn sure in 2 weeks you will know, or whatever it is. Don't put a time frame on it generally, but at some point, as soon as possible, you will know. So let's go to case study, Sony PlayStation 2. What I call the near death or death experience, finding cause and purpose and religion after the event. Between episode 1 and episode 2, Sony did an absolutely brilliant job of putting together best practices, of being able to identify, they had a task force that could identify information quickly. They were out in front of it. They were on every channel as quickly as they possibly could be. Facebook, Twitter, their own website, and did an absolutely phenomenal job of being out there. They talked about their capability, identified where even the gap was, what they hadn't looked at as critically as they should. And then they began to do something different, and it got picked up by a number of other organizations when they got hacked. One of the things that you do when there's a high probability of risk and high, moderate to high impact is find common cause. RSA, the sponsor of this convention, did an absolutely spectacular job in the aftermath of their hacking incident. They convened many of the top thinkers on technology risk, and particularly data privacy and security, because they recognized, and they were honest about it, that the state of the art, the practical state of the art in cybersecurity cannot keep up, nor there is absolutely no way that it can keep up with anonymous, with state actors, with cyber terrorists, as they call them, mischief makers, employees with an axe to grind. There's just no way. Because you'd develop a system that was absolutely immovable. The only way to have that kind of security protection is either spend millions, so you'd never make a profit, or have a system that you literally couldn't switch from one page to one application to another because of the security protections built into that, so you wouldn't get hacked. So there's a cost-benefit analysis that most people understand. But they talked about that. How do we talk about it? How does the public begin to understand that from a more informed point of view? So when we talk to the guidance for the security professional, a couple of things that we think are critically important for them to know. One is not all hacks are alike. You can, as we talked about, you can have a nation state that's stealing IP. You can have anonymous going in LULAC and a variety of other names that I can't really pronounce. You may have a disgruntled employee. You may have a WikiLeaks situation if you're the federal government and perhaps corporations and banks now, I hear. So not all are equal, and not all are viewed by the public and critical stakeholders in the same way. So equivalence is a false premise. So that you have to understand. Two, the security professionals and are a critically important part of the broader mosaic in crisis response. They are the subject matter experts. I was in a crisis recently involving a provider for debit card services. Got hacked. You would think that's their core business competency. They're getting hacked really went to the heart of it. They had an incredibly good story to tell based on all the protocols that they go through and the rigor of their data professionals and security professionals, IT security professionals. They didn't know, they couldn't access the content. They never thought about it. And it absolutely paralyzed them, and they went into what I call hide behind the lawyer's mode. When the lawyer says, no, don't say anything. Don't say anything, because there's legal risk. I call it the hide behind the lawyers. So forming that team of professionals, that team of people who are paid to think differently about problems, and that's the key here. The data security technology security person is paid to think differently than the lawyer, who's paid to think differently than the head of finance, that's paid to think differently than the communications and public affairs person and the board. All those people have a vital role, and you have to find that connectivity before the event if you've got any chance of getting out there with galactic speed. Literally, you have 40 minutes after an incident to be in the public domain, or you missed it. Helping prevent security breaches. We've seen in our practice quite a bit of hacking that's internal. And there's good internal communications can be an incredibly important source of avoiding sabotage, internal cyber sabotage, as we call it. If you've got an empowered employee base that feels that they're in the know and they don't feel the need to show you, particularly at technology companies, that they're a little bit smarter than the CEO, you do actually have a far better chance of mitigating or preventing that risk. So finally, what is the takeaway? Takeaway is that the chief security officers, CMOs, CIOs, have to start looking at their readiness plan. And they have to look at their readiness plan beyond function. Because crisis readiness is not a function, it's a capability. I always say companies in the aftermath of all the corporate frauds, the Enrons, the Tycos, WorldCom, you saw Sarbanes-Oxley passed, a lot of legislation, a lot of action. And companies were suddenly appointing chief ethics officers. Well, appointing a chief ethics officer does not make a company ethical in and of itself. So you have to look beyond function and look at capability. And looking at the unknowns and forming common cause around the unknowns, that is absolutely critical. Because today, in this day and age, where enterprise crises that are destabilizing has gone up 500%, it would be very silly to assume a risk for which a plan, just some planning, basic planning, could alleviate the issue to begin with. Thank you.